This is part three of lecture nine, discussing broadband modem technologies and performance of a variety of receivers on frequency selective fading channels. In the first part, I gave an overview of what is the meaning of frequency selective fading, and I also talked about the discrete channel model. In the second part, I talked about two particular receivers. One is discrete match filter or rake receiver, and the other one was the decision feedback equalizer, as two techniques to take advantage of time diversity of the channel. Now I will talk about two other techniques in multipath channels. One is smart antennas and the other one is OFDM. Equalization, decision feedback equalizer, is used in GSM, and discrete match filter is used in rake receivers. Smart antennas and OFDM are very popular in local area networks, wireless local area networks. First, talking about the spatial diversity schemes. Spatial diversity means that diversity means to create independent sources of signal. So one that we talked about was the regular space diversity. You put two antennas, you put them far apart, like in the order of lambda, to get independent received signal. Another way of like creating diversity is the so-called polarization diversity. You put one antenna vertical, one horizontal. This also provides, but it takes a smaller space than this one. Another, in fact, sort of a spatial diversity which you can create is using the so-called sectored antennas. Sectored antennas, really, they divide the space into different angle domains. And then, as a result, the multipath which is arriving is divided by six if you have six sectors and they are distributed linearly. If I divide the multipath by six, I can increase my data rate by six. That's one way to look at that. Okay. The sectored antennas originally, first time we used, as I said earlier, in ALTER project, which was one of the early wireless LANs designed at Motorola and for license bands, 18 to 19 gigahertz. And it was very effective, but wireless LAN industry has its own problems. Later on, sectored antennas was studied at lower frequencies, at 5 gigahertz, in HyperLAN 1 standard. And at the end, they decided to go to equalization for that particular application. Another way of using antennas are so-called smart antennas. These are adaptive antenna arrays that they adjust their pattern. So, for example, you have a mobile in here. As mobile is moving, you just chase the mobile with your antenna pattern. This way, you're reducing the interference from other people inside that. Anyways, all of these forms, they provide variety of spatial diversity which are exploited in the systems. Another more popular and more recent one is the MIMO technology that we just talked about space-time coding in the last lecture a little. With that introduction, I can give you some like specific examples related to sectored antennas. These are the results of Genning Yang, actually, one of my PhD students, early in 1990s. He compared the performance of this six-sectored antenna in multipath environments. And these are the data rates that he was getting. And this is the for different outage probability that he observes for different type of antenna patterns. In here, the antenna pattern is like this. They are not overlapping that much. In here, they are ideally mathematically separated. In here, they have some overlaps. And he sees the effect of that. Basically, the point is, if you want to calculate the performance of sectored antennas, it is sensitive to the formation of the antenna patterns. If you get ideal cases like this, or this case one, which is like a practical, non-overlapping, an optimal pattern which overlaps. The best performance is obviously with this one. Overlapping is the second best, and non-overlapping in the third best is the third best. This one. So, with that one in your mind, you come to the point that up to now we have talked about sectored antennas, and we have talked about decision feedback equalizers. How do they compare in terms of performance? And if I combine like a sectored antenna with a decision feedback equalizer, what would be the comparison? These are part of the work of Genning Yang as his PhD program. He took the channel impulse responses for different data rates in an indoor environment, and he takes omnidirectional antennas. This is the performance without using anything. This is the performance if you have omnidirectional antenna decision feedback equalizer. This is the performance if you have sectored antenna, and this is the performance if you have sectored antenna with decision feedback equalizer. This is your data rates. These are your probability of outage. The database that he is using is the measurements that we have taken inside the buildings in WPI. If you want to compare, for the outage rate of, like, let's say, 1%, for example, this is a reasonable outage rate. You can come up with, like, omnidirectional antennas and no equalization, no sector antenna. Your data rate, as you expected, is around 1 to 2 megabit per second. Earlier, we had find it, what, 1 to 4 megabit per second. This is the same thing, around 2 megabit per second. Actually, this is 4 megabit per second in here. When you come down and use decision feedback equalizer, your data rates goes up to like 14 megabit per second. If you use sectored antennas, you can go up to like 30 megabit per second. If you combine sectored antenna and decision feedback equalizer, you can go up to like 50 megabit per second. These are maximum data rates that you can achieve in an indoor environment to have an outage rate of 1%. And this also gives you a way to compare these things to one another. Okay? Other than that, so that's about like decision feedback equalizer, sectored antenna, and omnidirectional antennas. Now, one of the most effective and most popular modems currently is OFDM modems. OFDM basically is used in a variety of applications, but the basic concept is very simple. The basic concept of OFDM is that rather than sending one pulse, which is very narrow and over a wide band, you divide your band in very narrow bands and send them individually. This is called multi-carrier modulation. Do you remember? If I have narrow band communication, I don't have any inter-symbol interference. So rather than sending like one 20 megahertz bandwidth signal, I send 21 megahertz. Each of those 1 megahertz are not going to be heard by multipath. So I have a band like this, 20 megahertz, and these things are coming. Each of them are hitting only a small part. So they are not, I don't need equalizer or anything for the receive signal, because the receive signal is a narrow band signal. Okay? Now, what will happen to the channels which hit the deep fade? If I code those channels with the other channels, I can recover their data rate, their error rate. This particular scheme for implementation of OFDM, of the multi-carrier system, is called OFDM. The particular scheme is that I'm taking the information, I go to the signal constellation, then I use inverse Fourier transform, and then I send my pulses. At the receiver, I turn back with using a Fourier transform, and I get my symbols back. This is multi-carrier modulation implemented using fast Fourier transform. Means that I have a bunch of carriers, and then I take the Fourier transform of them, inverse Fourier transform, and send them in time domain, and then at the receiver, I sample them in time domain, I take Fourier transform, I go to frequency domain, I have my data back in here, and then I decode them. This technique is referred to as OFDM. OFDM originally was introduced, OFDM multi-carrier originally was introduced like in 1960 for voiceband modems. And then OFDM also for voiceband modems was introduced in early 1980s. And in early 1990s, people tried to apply that to the radio channels. And in 1998, it became adopted by 802.11a. And then later on, around 2000, it became choice for 802, after 2000 actually, 2002 I believe, it became the choice for 802.11g. And today is one of the most, I mean, popular techniques. The particular OFDM, which is used in 802.11, has 64 point for the FFT, so 64 carrier. They use 48 of that for data and 4 for pilot, and 12 are virtual subcarriers. Now, the way that they handle that, they change the data rates based on modulation technique in each of the carriers. So each carrier can have binary PSK up to 64 QAM. And based on that, you can change your data rate. Now, I think, and this curve actually gives the probability of error versus like signal to noise ratio for different modulation technique that they have. But your project 4 is actually implementation of OFDM for 802.11a and g, and this few slides is explaining that. So your data is coming in, so you get the serial data, you transfer them, convert them to parallel. In the particular example that you have QPSK modulation. Means that the data comes in, every 2 bits becomes 1 symbol. Okay? And then these symbols are coming to QPSK subcarrier to encode them. The way that you encode, this is the encoder. If it's 0, 0, it comes in here. If it is 1, 1, it becomes in here. 1, 0 is this, 0, 0 here. Okay? So based on the 2 bits that you have either +1, -1, or +1, 1. These are complex symbols. Okay? XI plus JYI. Okay? This would be 1 plus J. This would be -1 plus J. So you find these complex symbols, okay? And you create these complex symbols, then you want to go to the inverse Fourier transform. Now, to go to the inverse Fourier transform, you have to have like this cyclic form. So if you have 1 to 26 symbols, you put the inverse of that in here, -1 to here. So you have a 64 point FFT. The first one would be null. The next 26 would be like your data, which is coming from your encoder. And then you will have between 27 and 37, you have nulls. Then you have 1, 2, 26 in the negative form. Okay? This is because FFT is cyclic. It repeats itself. Okay? It has to be like symmetric. And then you have 64 bits output, 64 symbols output in here. Then you have to just use the inverse Fourier transform to come back. And then from the Fourier transform, at the beginning you have created this bit according to this structure, and then you have the serial data. It comes in here, and then you pass it to fast Fourier transform this time, and you get your symbols back. And then you put them in the parallel form, and you have your data bits. Then you compare the data bits with the transmitted bits to see that how much error you have for different signal to noise ratios. That's basically your project. I think it's a very good project, and that will adequately explain the OFDM for you, understanding of the OFDM. Another issue is the comparison of OFDM with others. This particular graphs, figure 933 and 934, they are comparing the performance of OFDM with 16, 32, coded OFDM. Means that the channels that I'm sending, they're coded to one another. So one of them goes to fade, I can recover the error. And coded OFDM, decision feedback effort, this is sectored antennas, and this is decision feedback antenna with sector antennas. These are the performance of all of them in this particular thing in a channel with 10 megahertz bandwidth. In here, I have the same thing when I don't have limited bandwidth, but I have a power of 20 dBm. I have fixed power, but bandwidth is changing. And I'm comparing the same modulations to one another. I use this figure 3.9.33 and 9.34 for actually problem 3 of your homework assignment. And based on that, you can compare the performances. These results are developed based on another simulation with one of my PhD students did in mid-1990s. That's before the adoption of OFDM. Okay. And what he did, he goes to second floor of Atwater Kent Laboratories. He takes the measurements that Steve Howard has done, which are 680-something points inside this building. And for each of these channel profiles, he generates a lot of random phase and calculates the probability of outage for different type of modulation techniques, and then compares the performance. So the performance that you have in here and here are associated to performance in one real measured indoor radio channel. Okay. And what you are going to do is you're really reading and interpreting this data to just compare the performance of different modems with one another. And with that one, I think I will close this lecture. If you don't have any questions. Any questions? So basically what I did in this third part, very quickly, I talked about your project on the OFDM, and also I talked about a brief overview of effect of space diversity, and then I introduced you this performance comparison curves that you're using in your assignment number 9. In one of the problems. For those of you who had other courses with me, these things were part of other courses, actually, like mobile data course, for example. And with that, I will close this lecture.